Welcome to Healthcare Du Jour, where we dish up and digest the latest in healthcare. For the next 30 minutes, sit back as we bring you insight, commentary, and discussion on trending topics to the table, all expertly served up by our host and his guests. Healthcare Du Jour is brought to you by High Tech Answers and Healthcare Now Radio, part of the Answers Media Network, and is sponsored by the Law Offices of Myrick O'Connell. Now here is your host, Matt Fisher.
Welcome back, and thank you for joining as we dive into the hottest topics in healthcare. I'm your host, Matt Fisher. On the menu today is Ligia Ricciardi, Chief Transformation Officer at Carium, and another returning guest. And also, this is going to be the second in the series of podcasts with fellow members of the HIMSS Digital Influencer Program. So, Ligia, welcome back to the program.
Thank you so much, Matt. I'm excited to join you again.
Yeah, no, it'll be great to be able to catch up and see how things have changed. But, you know, since it's been a couple of years since you've been on the show, would you like to just give everyone kind of a quick update again on who you are and kind of what you've been doing over the past couple of years?
Yeah, sure. So my career has generally been spent in trying to use technology to empower consumers and patients with regard to their health. And I've done that in the private sector, the public sector, a number of different roles. I spent some time in the Office of the National Coordinator of Health IT, which is part of the Department of Health and Human Services. And I really set up and built a lot of the work there on the policy front that was trying to empower consumers and give them access to their health records and their data so that they could be more engaged in their health. And that involved working on policy, working with a lot of different stakeholder groups, including patients, and bringing them together. So I think after that, I think was when we last spoke, I spent a number of years running a consulting practice related to the same kinds of themes. And now I have joined, it's been about a year and a half or so, a company called Carium, which is a technology company, which is building a platform for collaborative care. So for me, this is a cool transition because it's moving from the public sector and the 30,000 foot view of how do we empower consumers to a very applied case of how do we build tools that in real life consumers can use to be more engaged in their health, to be healthier, and to connect better with their providers. So that's where I am now.
So kind of as you've gone through that transition that you just mentioned of the public sector into arguably a more targeted private focus, kind of how has your thinking about the healthcare industry changed?
Yeah, I would say this. Well, for one thing, it's interesting for me to switch from different vantage points within the kind of broad community of folks working on healthcare and technology. And I feel strongly that too often we try to, we need to help bridge kind of differences among different stakeholder groups. I think Washington is notorious sometimes for having its own echo chamber and not really understanding what's going on in big tech or in Silicon Valley or in healthcare. It's not just Washington, though. I think that on the other side, too, technology companies, whether big or small, or healthcare companies, can tend to get a bit insular. And it's really important for us all to kind of bridge the different divides and help people think about the perspectives of others. Very big picture, a lot of us share the goals of improving healthcare outcomes and making life better for patients and providers. And if we can think about ways to work together, we can make that happen. I'd say in terms of my thinking over time, I've realized and come to really appreciate how hard it is to make change. And on the one hand, I've seen a huge amount of change in the world of digital health. Certainly technology has advanced very rapidly over the 20 or so years that I've been involved in this area, but it is very hard to change human behaviors. It's hard to change institutions. It's hard to change people's thinking. And that's where the challenge is, much more than in changing technology.
So thinking about those challenges, are you focusing on any particular area within the industry to maybe use as a microcosm or an example of a way to positively kind of improve how those interactions occur?
Sure. So one example that I would take based on my work at Carium is we have been active in the area of remote patient monitoring, or RPM. And that's an interesting area for me because it has particularly strong overlaps with policy. All of healthcare, compared to many other industries, is linked to policy very deeply, largely because the government is the biggest payer for healthcare services through CMS mostly, but also because the government just tends to set policies that have massive effect on others as well. So for example, CMS pays for Medicare beneficiaries' care, but it also, the kinds of decisions that it makes influence private payers. So remote patient monitoring is an interesting area because it's one in which there have been some recent policy changes. So about a year ago, CMS issued several new payment codes for reimbursement for remote patient monitoring services. And this is exciting because it is a concrete step forward in a big shift from fee-for-service to value-based care. And that's exciting because on the other side, so wearing my Carium hat, if you're building a service that you want healthcare providers to use, all of a sudden they've got a concrete financial incentive to do so where they didn't in the past. So that's one area where I see particular promise.
So kind of before exploring the area more, maybe if we could take a step back, and would you be able to explain what remote patient monitoring actually entails to make sure everyone fully understands what it is?
Sure. So basically what it involves is the use of devices like blood pressure monitors, blood glucose monitors, digital scales that can be in a patient's home and that can be digitally connected to a care team so that the care team can monitor data from the patient while the patient is in their home and also interact with that patient from the distance of, you know, the care provider may be located in a hospital, a clinic, whatever, but they're having these interactions on a virtual basis. And the codes from CMS have particular requirements about which patients can be served. They have to be people who are Medicare recipients and they have to have two chronic conditions. They have to be, there are specific details about how much interaction there must be between the provider and the patient over the course of a month, those kinds of things. But big picture, what this is enabling is care that would have required a visit perhaps into the office or multiple visits to be able to take place from the home.
So kind of with that description, it sounds like the push to reimburse these services, as you were saying, and the scope of them aligns with kind of the changing focus of healthcare to preventative and kind of whole person care as opposed to just responding to symptoms once they've arisen.
Yeah, I think that's really well said, Matt. I think when providers have access to regular data about their patients, that allows them to look at populations as a whole and really focus in on those particular individuals who need care, who may be at risk of developing a worse problem or having an acute care episode, and they're able to reach out to that person and actually intervene, which is exciting. Also, the point about sort of whole person health, if you are monitoring someone from the context of their home or their daily life, right? Patients aren't home all the time. You spend a lot of your time outside. Even a retiree is going to spend probably a bulk of their time not necessarily in their home. But you're able to see how their data, how their health is being impacted in the context of daily life, which is really important because in the past, if someone would come in, particularly for care for a chronic condition like high blood pressure, they'd come into the office and that would be the only time the provider would get to do a reading of their blood pressure, which might be artificially high because of what's called white coat syndrome, where people are just nervous and uncomfortable about being in the doctor. It doesn't give you a real sense or an ability to see patterns like, okay, I see that this patient's blood pressure is usually, you know, spikes in a particular context. That might be something worth talking about that you could change.
And kind of your mention of being able to gather multiple data points and in more the regular course of daily life, it sounds like it's really trying to create a more accurate snapshot of the patient's lifestyle as well.
Yeah, so I think although RPM reimbursement by CMS is only for a few specific measures. There are broader lifestyle factors that absolutely contribute to and shape life and health and wellness as a whole. So, for example, what we eat, how much we sleep, levels of stress, all of these things may not be directly part of this initial program right now, but they feed into this bigger picture of habits and behaviors that are really much more important in the long term to shaping overall health and outcomes than some of the more, you know, specific actions that might be related to just an episode of care. So this is where I think we really need to move as a society. I think as a whole, we do a good job from a healthcare system perspective of treating accidents and injuries and acute situations. We have many amazing treatments and interventions, but what we're not so good at is managing everyday chronic conditions. And increasingly, particularly as our population ages, the proportion of people who have chronic conditions goes up. Many of us are living longer, and that's where we need to get better. And that requires not just the application of amazing life-saving technologies in a hospital, but it's helping individuals, people, to manage everyday tasks in ways that support their own health. It's realizing that there's a greater responsibility and pressure, I guess, in a sense, if you will, on individuals, on each of us as patients and consumers, than on the health system. And we need to encourage and support individuals in living the healthiest lives that they can.
So what are some of the more effective ways that you're seeing that provide that encouragement and support?
Yeah, so one thing is just having more data now than we ever did before. We can measure all kinds of activities like movement, and we plug into wearables that address some of these lifestyle factors and enable people to track food and movement and other things, as well as things like blood pressure. And just having more data enables both patients and providers to make what's before been invisible, visible. So as an example, on our platform, we ask patients who use it every single day, there's a simple question: how are you feeling today? And you don't have to answer that in text. You're presented with an array of faces ranging from very happy to rather miserable, and you just kind of press on which one is right for you that day. So as a user myself, I do that. And I find it really interesting to go back over time, because I can access this on the platform as a patient, a graph, and I can see how I've done and how I've assessed my own mood over the last, you know, week or month or year even. And it's fascinating to me to be able to go back and say, oh yeah, why was my mood lower in that period than it was in that period? Maybe it corresponds to something environmental. You know, it was cold and I was, not sleeping very well or whatever was going on. Or maybe it corresponds to something that was going on in my relationships, in my life. And just having the ability to look at data to see patterns that you wouldn't otherwise catch, because it's hard to remember exactly if someone said, hey, how did you feel last summer, last July? How did your symptoms or just your mood compare between last July and now? Most of us would be hard-pressed to really answer that question. But when you have the ability to easily track that kind of thing, and then an option to look at data in aggregate and get a sense of overall patterns, you can start to learn some interesting things. So making the formerly invisible visible is really powerful, both for patients themselves and for providers. And I think the other thing that we've discovered, I don't know that this is so surprising, but many of us who've worked in digital health for a while have focused a lot on getting people access to data. That is really important. As I just said, that is proven to be true. But it also helps to have data in the context of a human connection. And the way we do that with our product is by linking a patient to a provider or a coach who can help to not only interpret data, but to also give encouragement and support and be a guide that keeps you motivated and interested in overcoming life's daily challenges, which can be hard enough if you're just trying to generally manage wellness. But if you're dealing with a chronic condition, it can be overwhelming, and it can be easy to put your health second in your, or maybe even lower on the list than second. If, like me, you're managing a busy life in which you have an intense job, a family, kids, household issues. So having the connection to a human makes a real difference too.
Yeah, and for those of you just joining, I'm talking with Ligia Ricciardi from Carium, and we've been talking about new models that are putting more of an emphasis on lifestyle management and kind of, Ligia, as you're just saying, empowering an individual. And you know, kind of that was a concept that out of what you were just saying that really seemed to resonate, which is, as you said, there are more tools out there that are putting increasing amounts of data, not just into the hands of the clinicians, but also to the individuals. And I was fascinated by what you're saying about when an individual has that data, it can help you spot trends about your own health or your own feelings of well-being. And how do you see that influencing interactions when you're actually in front of your physician or other member of the care team?
Yeah. So obviously different people will use this in different ways. But for myself, I think it helps me be better informed about my own body and my own questions so that I can bring data that I've been tracking into the context of an encounter with my provider and share it. But also, if we're using a tool like Carium, they already have a lot of that context. And so when you do have those in-person encounters, they're able to be a lot more effective and targeted, because you don't have to start with the big picture. How have you been? How have things improved since the last time I saw you, which may have been weeks or months ago? You can home right in on the key points and maybe questions or concerns that you have. And also, it's important because if we have a lot of data on the individual, we can get a sense of what's appropriate or normal for me as an individual, as opposed to the general public. So just as an example, I have two kids, one of whom was born with a heart defect. And there was a lot of discussion during her first year of life about whether or not we had to operate on her to close a hole in her heart that was essentially draining energy, blood flow from her body, and perhaps slowing her from developing normally. And one of the signs that this hole was having an impact was that she was very low weight. Well, that's true. And if you put her weight on a graph as a newborn and as a, you know, baby relative to weights of newborns across the whole country, she was indeed perhaps alarmingly light. But if you went back, as some of our family members did, and looked at, like, what was my birth weight? What was my husband's birth weight? What's normal for our family? And where do we tend to be on this overall graph? In context, you could see, okay, just the fact that this kid is relatively light compared to other members of the population is not in itself cause for alarm. That's just one example of sort of trying to figure out what's normal for you. But it's really important because I think often out of context, both certainly providers, but even patients themselves may say, whoa, well, I'm not like everybody else. Yeah, I mean, you're unique. And the more you can understand how you compare and how you're different from the general population, it allows you to be treated in a way that is most likely to have a positive impact for you.
No, that's a very interesting observation, since medicine being, you know, a very scientific-based profession and practice, likes to go to kind of old, kind of reliable standards, I'll call it. And you want to measure against a standard without kind of, as you were saying, thinking about, well, maybe this person doesn't fit that model. And, you know, kind of the whole evolution of thinking to, you know, it probably fits into the broader category of precision medicine or individualized medicine. And, you know, as you were suggesting, thinking about, okay, this person might look like they're deviating from where they should be, but if you look at their personal or their family history, no, they're right in line with where they should be.
Exactly. Very well said. I think that's absolutely right. And I think data enables us to do both precision medicine and population health are really exciting. You want to look at whole populations and generalizations and be able to figure out where there are differences within that so that you know where you can really make an impact as a healthcare provider. At the same time, you want to realize that each individual kind of is on their own unique journey and has parameters that are different from anybody else's. And if we can dive deep into that and understand it better, then we can really help each person to thrive.
And if we're continuing down that path, kind of what challenges does that present to the professionals in the healthcare field? So thinking, you know, probably mostly about the physicians and other clinicians and the organizations they're in. And, you know, kind of along with that, you know, how can those individuals and organizations be supported and encouraged to change the model and by which they're delivering care?
Yeah, I think really the whole model needs to evolve, not only because there are all kinds of pressures that it cannot sustain, cost being one of the biggest ones, but also because there's this positive opportunity to use things like new technologies to totally redesign care. It shouldn't be so episodic and based on reaction to injuries, accidents, and illnesses as they come up. We want the whole system to move to one that's much more continuous, integrated with life, and prevention oriented. And in order to make that switch, I think we need to think less about building large hospitals and emphasizing time with a provider, perhaps a highly specialized one, to go over all kinds of things and push our system more toward an emphasis on not only primary care, but also bringing in allied health professionals who may not be MDs, but are well-trained in understanding the basics of cardiometabolic health and behavioral health and helping people manage and feel cared for everyday life. And again, spotting problems or potential problems before they get really big and, as necessary, bringing those into some of the providers and specialists who are appropriately trained to deal with those. But I see in the optimal world, we'll use technology and hopefully payment models will support this as well to make healthcare much more decentralized and to move it out from institutions and into people's daily lives, into greater responsibility within communities and responsibility and participation, within communities and environments. And technology enables us to not only empower people to better understand what's going on with their health, but lets us better extend the healthcare resources that we do have.
So with that kind of goal in mind, and I think you were kind of implicitly saying it, you know, the reimbursement models need to change because, you know, I think hopefully people recognize that the system is still predominantly fee for service. And a lot of what we've been talking about would arguably lose you money in that type of a model, absent, you know, kind of, you know, I think as you said earlier, the targeted change, at least from Medicare for the remote patient monitoring, where those particular services are being reimbursed, but still on a fee for service basis. You know, so kind of how can organizations be encouraged to adopt and change and evolve their models of care if they're trying to balance it against the financial pressures?
Yeah, I think a lot of healthcare organizations are very much feeling the difficulty right now of the imperative to move eventually toward value-based care, but feeling like they're not there yet. And right now, their bread and butter really comes from fee-for-service type activities. So the RPM, remote patient monitoring payment, is interesting to me because it is a bridge that enables organizations who are still operating in a fee-for-service model to start providing and branch out into more of these patient-centric, decentralized kinds of care models not just because, okay, we'll get reimbursed for them, so this supports our existing model, but it's a stepping stone toward value-based care. Eventually, as those organizations take on more risk and are remunerated not for the volume of care that they provide, but for the ultimate outcomes and health and well-being of the people that they serve, they're going to have to think more about supporting people in daily life and doing things like remote patient monitoring and other types of telehealth, because they have to. I mean, so much of our health, particularly when it comes to things like chronic conditions, as we were talking about, really depends on the engagement and involvement of the patient, ideally supported both by technology and by caring and well-informed professionals who can help them do that at a distance. But we are in a difficult bridge period right now, and services like RPM can be a relatively safe way, a stepping stone that organizations who provide healthcare in traditional ways can use to move themselves on this journey of transformation toward more value-based care.
Yeah, and believe it or not, we're almost out of time. So kind of that last question gives a perfect setup, I think, for our final question, which would be, you know, in an ideal world, what immediate change would you like to make to healthcare to kind of reach that almost rip the Band-Aid off type inflection point to really get more into the value world that we've just been talking about?
Yeah, so I would love to see, from a policy perspective, CMS in particular, but also private payers too, really turn up the volume on the you know, switch in payment for value as opposed to volume. I think also as a part of that, I would like to see greater transparency in the system and helping consumers not only get access to information about their care and their bodies and so on, but also to understand the payment a little bit more. I think that part of our challenge in healthcare today is we have a lot of inefficiencies, and it's hard to understand the system as a patient or even as someone who works in it sometimes. And there are many ways in which money kind of gets siphoned off or lost by you know, intermediaries who don't necessarily add a ton of value. And the more we shed light on the economics of the system and help people understand, for example, that they may be able to get a particular prescription for a cheaper price if they pay for it without insurance, as opposed to going through their insurer. Things like that start to enable people as individuals to exercise some of their power and start to erode some of the power of middlemen who are benefiting from the old system. So I think that transparency piece is really important, in addition to really pushing up the, as I said, the kind of the payment models. The kind of work that CMS is already doing, and some of the private payers as well, but turning up the volume on that would be the most valuable thing that I think anyone could do for this whole system.
Well, hopefully we'll see some of that. But as I said, believe it or not, we are already out of time. I want to thank my guest, Ligia Ricciardi, for a great conversation today.
Thank you, Matt. It's been a pleasure speaking with you.
Yeah, no, it's been great to have you back on. And thank you to everyone listening. Keep the dialogue going and connect with me at hashtag HCDEJURE. I'm Matt Fisher. Until next time.